It's amazing what $1,600 can get you these days. And you know what? The thing is, you don't even really have to skimp on the parts, nor look at having to upgrade in like a year or two because you're like, dang, it just wasn't powerful enough. But what I love about this build we were talking about today is that not only is this beast well south of $2,000 USD, but it also has a display that lets you see what's going on with the PC. So let's check out this all AMD powered Deepcool CH360 digital build, which, by the way, if you like seeing builds in the latest cases with all the latest and greatest hardware, make sure you like and subscribe and ring that notification bell so you don't miss out on videos like this one. Now, let's build. So let's go and jump in and take a look at what we're actually putting inside of it. Okay, so here's what we're actually doing. We're gonna be using the AMD Ryzen 5 7600X. We're using the ASRock B650M PG Riptide Wi-Fi motherboard, the ASRock AMD Radeon RX 7800 XTPG, Corsair MP600 Elite 2TB NVMe drive. We got 32 gigs of 6000 mega transfer Triton Z Neo, which means it's got Expo timings for RAM. We have the Deepcool AK620 Zero Dark, and then the Corsair RM750E as our PSU. And the whole thing for this ends up coming out right around $1,600. Okay, well, let's go ahead and start building. Let's go ahead and grab our components. Okay, so here we go. Here's our PG Riptide. So kicking it off first with our 7600X. And I like to keep the cover on just to protect it. And we'll do, let's do 95 for the RAM today. I know, actually we'll do 96. Let's do 96 for the RAM today. Okay, drop this in. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Ooh, 92. 95.7, okay, 96. 93.8, sorry guys, it did not hit it today. Deepcool's gonna love this. We're gonna use the Deepcool AK620 Zero Dark. Really looking for something that just kind of overall matches the theme. So I wanted something that with all the black and everything else would just look really good. There we go. Now it's time for a little case stripping. Most important thing here is just to make sure that we do not get these cables stuck in there. So there, all of our cables are plugged in now. And all of our cable management is done. Let's put in our cable extensions. That's gonna go right there. There we go, that's in. Cool. Okay, get our GPU in. Definitely will fill out this little case. There we go. What do you guys think? I think that looks good. So we're gonna grab our RM750E. There we go. Takes a little bit of effort there, but we got it done. There we go. And I'm gonna go ahead and put the glass on because it's really meant for having the glass on. There we go. Wow, that actually goes on really easily. Okay, here we go, guys. 3, 2, 1. First off, it's not a bad looking rig at all, and from a difficulty standpoint, a very approachable build for any first time builder. Remember, I try very hard during the live streams to ensure that I show you all the steps, so if you watch them, for the most part, you can follow along and build a PC yourself. And you wanna check that out, you can actually check it out right here. Now, to make this little bad boy even more impressive is that when you head over to Newegg and you look at pre-built gaming PCs around the same price, you see like older 5000 series AMD CPUs. One of them had like 64 gigs of RAM with like a 512 NVMe. You see 3050s and 1060s and maybe a 4060 and a lot of hard drives and very small NVMe drives. But when you look at this system, it's got the latest Ryzen 5 7600X. It's got matching brands of motherboard and GPU, meaning that all the RGB works together and there's less overhead. It's got 32 gigs of 6000 mega transfer RAM. It's got 2 terabytes of Gen 4 storage as opposed to a hard disk drive. It's got a 7800 XT. Not a 4060, not a 6600X. It's got a 7800 XT and all of this for $1,600. I'm just saying that that's a lot of power in just this one little tiny box. But let's see how good this bad boy performs, starting with thermals, which means, you know what, we need to talk about how we set up the Deepcool CH360 Digital from an airflow standpoint. In front, we're using two stock 140 millimeter ARGB fans to feed not only the Deepcool AK620 dark air cooler, but also that ASRock AMD Radeon RX 7800 XT PG GPU, which in both cases are exhausted via the stock 120 millimeter ARGB fan in the back, which you can see via the airflow demonstration we're showing you right here. Now, not sure you saw our Air Cooler Olympics, which if you haven't, you should actually check it out right here, but the AK620 Dark has a maximum heat dissipation of 260 watts, which means if you wanted to add the extra $200 and jump up to like a Ryzen 7 7800X3D and just go all gaming, you're gonna absolutely be able to do that. But you're saying, that's nice, Roby, you're already talking about potential upgrades, but how did this build perform thermally and in games? Well, fine. Let's break it down. Beginning with CPU temperatures, given the 7600X can handle both gaming and any workhorse applications like rendering, compiling, etc., we're gonna show you idle gaming and under full load. Kicking it off with idle with the AK620 Dark, we saw a nice and low 36 degrees. When jumping up to gaming, which let's be honest, that's where most of us are gonna be hanging out, we saw a nice and moderate 63 degrees Celsius. And finally, when we put this thing under full load, reaching a Cinebench R23 score of 14520, we saw a very healthy 85 degrees, which leaves us plenty of headroom for workstation level tasks. For GPU, it's, well, pretty much even a better story. While at idle, you're looking at a nice and reasonable 36 degrees Celsius, and for both gaming and workload, which essentially are the same thing, we saw a moderate and nowhere near scary 61 degrees on our ASRock RX 7800 XT PG. So thermally, we got no issue at all. But now for the most important and impressive part of this little beast, how it performs in gaming. So kicking it off with Cyberpunk 2077 at 1440p with ray tracing and ultra and FSR 2.1 set to auto, we saw Cyberpunk 2077 hitting a nice and solid 61 frames per second. Given this is a ray trace heavy title and very heavily NVIDIA focused, 61 FPS is great for an AMD GPU and for playing Cyberpunk. And you know what, if you wanted to drop the ray tracing down to medium or low, you should get consistently very well north of 60 FPS for your entire gameplay experience without a significant visual drop. But let's be honest, 60 FPS in a single player game, especially something like Cyberpunk, is gonna be great. For Starfield, running at 1440p at the highest graphical setting and FSR set to auto, we saw 85 FPS on average while running in both space and around on planets, which was perfectly fine. Next up, we have Forza Horizon 5, again 1440p with graphics set to extreme, FSR 2.2 set to auto, we saw 139 FPS. For Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3, again at 1440p, extreme graphics, FSR 2.1 set to balance, and fluid motion frames on, we were sitting at 364 frames per second for single player campaign, which is bonkers. For Shadow of the Tomb Raider, 1440p with the highest graphical preset, XeSS set to balance, you're looking at 178 FPS. And remember, there's no FSR here, and Intel is GPU agnostic, so Intel helping AMD here is actually pretty awesome. And finally, rounding out our single player games, we have Tiny Tina's Wonderland with graphics set to badass and FSR 2.0 set to balance. We saw 164 frames per second. For MP titles, we kick it off with Apex Legends with graphics maximized for competitive gameplay. We saw 269 FPS at 1440p. For some COD multiplayer action, of course, this time optimizing for maximum frame rate, not using any frame generation, basically just trying to get it raw and perfect, 226 FPS for some multiplayer, that's pretty awesome. And finally, Fortnite, again, graphics set to competitive, maximizing frame rate. We said we had an almost pretty much unplayable 408 FPS. Boo, what the heck? Of course, I am being absolutely sarcastic. So there you guys have it. It's a $1,600 PC that blows away the competition of any other pre-built PC that's around the same price. And it's also A, very easy to put together and get set up, and B, absolutely crushes at gameplay, and as a bonus, is able to manage productivity-focused applications and workloads as well. Not to mention, it's upgradable in almost every way. GPU, CPU, I mean, again, there's a lot of potential here. And that's not bad for the price. But what do you think? Do you like the build? I know you're secretly judging me, so what would you change and what would you upgrade if you could? Let us know all that down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, hit that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post videos like this right here on Robitech. Also, if you have questions, you want to discuss builds like this, make sure to join our Discord server, discord.gg/Robitech, which, you know what? You might just make a friend. Also, feel free to follow me at Robitech absolutely everywhere. That's it for me. Thanks for watching, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one.